Welcome to the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility on the Horn, an ongoing inquiry into American political systems and evolving political structures. The executive director of the Virtual Center is Dr. Bill O'Brien. He's also your host for this conversation. Here he is now, Dr. Bill O'Brien.
Thank you, Bob Kincaid, and welcome to today's program at the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. It is a pleasure to be with you on this midweek, this Wednesday. It is the 30th day of October. Tomorrow, at least in our area, is Valentine's Day. I know it is. I said that yesterday as well. I am so sorry. It is Halloween. Actually, to be honest with you, Halloween's not one of my favorite days. I don't really have anything against it, except I find it uncomfortable when so many people emphasize grotesque stuff, and I've always felt that way. So, but I was very interested. I read an article in the last few days about you know, what's hot and what's not in terms of Valentine's masks and costumes for this Valentine's Day. And what they were basically saying is that presidential masks are not as big this year as they have been in the past. And it stands to reason that, you know, a few years ago, the Obama mask was very popular. And they talked about how some over the years, some of the presidential lookalikes have been very popular in the market with kids and everything. And I've told this to my wife. She laughs, but I can't help it. I remember one year at Valentine's Day, my mom got me a Harry Truman mask, and I went around trick-or-treating with a Harry Truman mask on, and I really thought I was the cat. I really thought I was cool. So that kind of dates me a little bit and kind of tells you where I am. And it wasn't part of a history class either. It was kind of in tune with the times, if you know what I mean. So anyway, tomorrow is Halloween, and today is midweek. Tonight is the sixth game of the World Series, this time coming from Boston, and I obviously am very, very interested. I have told myself that I'm not going to be distressed or distracted from having a good attitude, even though the Red Sox might lose this, because they have another chance tomorrow. But I really think that their best shot is tonight. Once it gets to the seventh game on Halloween, there's no telling what will happen. So I believe tonight's the night. And, of course, they're facing Michael Walker, who has just been absolutely unhittable. So, anyway, it is it's a big day, and it's what one of the things that makes it big is the fact that I can be here and spend a couple of hours with the folks on the Horn and those who turn in regularly to the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution. I look forward to this all day long. In fact, we were out doing some shopping today, and I kind of my wife made the comment and said, "What, you look like you're far away. You're just kind of gazing off into space." And of course, the grocery store will do that to you sometimes. But anyway, I told her that I was kind of thinking about today's program, and I guess what I'm saying is, I look forward. I anticipate it. I always get a little bit nervous because I want to make sure that it's a program that, when it's over, I really feel like it's a good thing that it happened. And most of the times, I honestly do feel that way. Every once in a while something will happen to kind of interrupt that a little bit, but most of the time I can honestly say that I feel pretty good. Yesterday I was a little bit uncertain because even though I had a lot of substantive items and issues that I wanted to deal with, the first hour I kind of went off on a tirade, but on the other hand, I really believe that it had significant value. And what I mean is, it kind of suggests where you can go with some of this stuff. Once you get your arms around some of these concepts and some of these theories, you can really take them and apply them. And a lot of things that used to not make any sense sometimes begin to if we do that. So with that in mind, I want to welcome you to today's program here at the Virtual Center. And I want to thank you for your willingness to give us a portion of your valuable time. I really appreciate it, and I want to invite you to join us here live at the Virtual Center on the air with your comments or your suggestions. We have a phone number, and with a little bit of button pushing, not on my part, on Bob Kincaid and his folks will do that, we will get you on the air. The phone number is area code 304, and the number is 658-3333. That's 304-658-3333. My email address, if you'd like to communicate directly with me, is waobryan906@gmail.com. That's waobryan906@gmail.com. Received a link yesterday, actually from Bob Kincaid, and I know that some of you have probably seen this, but I thought it was really interesting because Bob's point was that this struck him and he thought that I'd like to see it if I hadn't seen it, because he related it to some of the issues and conversation that we've had here at the Virtual Center, and specifically, it relates to the story that was around the net yesterday about the Nevada Tea Party Republican who said that if his constituents wanted it, he would vote to bring back slavery. And you know, this obviously, for a lot of reasons, this struck Bob, it struck me, and basically from the article, Jim Wheeler from Nevada, from Gardnerville, Nevada, made the point. It says, if that's what they wanted, meaning his constituents, I'd have to hold my nose, I'd have to bite my tongue, and they'd probably have to hold a gun to my head. But yeah, if that's what the citizens of the, if that's what the constituency wants the elected, wants that, elected me, in other words, if that's the reason they elected me, that's what they elected me for, that's what a republic is about. And he said to the media, if this is making it around, and of course a lot of people, especially liberals, are obviously struck by this. This is rather shocking in this day and age. Given the realities of the world we live in, one of which is we have an African-American president, it's pretty obvious that that's not, I'm sure that that's not lost on our Tea Party friend from Nevada. Bob Kincaid is right. You know, if you remember, Madison made the point very, very clearly that one of the advantages, one of the benefits of the Constitution over the Confederation was that it was going to free elected representatives from being totally and directly accountable to what the majority constituency or the majority faction within their constituency wanted. And if you remember, we talked about the fact that Edmund Burke made this point in a very, very famous speech in Great Britain about the different roles of the representative. The representative as the agent of the people who does what the people tell him to do versus the elected representative as the trustee of the people who makes decisions on behalf of his constituents. And of course Edmund Burke's position was that the only one that can work is the election of representative as the trustee of the people. But then he emphasized that even though that's the choice that he prefers, the fact of the matter is the only way that the representative can represent his constituency well is to know his constituents. And so the fact that there needs to be close proximity and regular interaction between elected official, elected representative, and constituents is still very important, and that's the key to a Republican form of government. Madison's position, if you remember the vices of the political system of the United States that he talked about, Madison's position was that that was one of the major flaws or one of the major weaknesses of the Articles of Confederation, is that because the states were so small, relatively speaking, in you know, against the backdrop of the entire Union, that it was possible for a majority faction to form. And of course, we know that Madison was most concerned because the majority faction was the poor. And when the poor organized and are able to use majority rule to seize control of the political apparatus of the state and use it to their own advantage, Madison's position is that was one of the major weaknesses of the Confederation period. And the way they do that is if there is a majority faction, then by definition, the elected representative either votes according to the will of the majority or he's ousted the next year. One of the things that the Confederation featured in Congress, in the legislative branch, was annual elections. So these guys were required to stand accountable to the people in their state, in their constituency, every year. And so that meant that the public never had to put up with a recalcitrant representative who did his own thing rather than what the people wanted him to do for too long. And Madison's position in the Constitution was, and this is a key part of Federalist Number 10, that by enlarging the sphere, enlarging the district which the representative represents, you take in more factions, more different and competing interest groups, and you make it less likely that there will be a majority faction. Or, and of course there's always a majority faction, or, says Madison, if there is a majority faction, the people who belong to it will not know that they are part of a majority, and therefore they will be unable to organize and execute their plans of oppression. And again, the key thing here is, I think Madison believes that if the majority are able to organize and get together and exercise their will, he defines that as oppression. And so in a sense, the irony of this whole thing is that James Madison and the Constitution of the United States had created a system, a definition of representation and Republican government, which would make it unnecessary for a representative like Mr. Wheeler from Nevada to respond to his constituents at all, unless, of course, he chose to. And so I think that's probably what we're dealing with our friend Mr. Wheeler. Because actually, James Madison had taken him off the hook long, long ago from having to be responsive to the constituents. And I would suggest that all of this stuff about holding his nose and putting a gun to his head, I would suggest the only part of that that's probably true is that he definitely would have a gun. I think we could pretty well be sure of that. Anyway, I appreciate Bob sending me that link again, and I wanted to make that point because I'm kind of guessing that particular link was very popular yesterday. I was mentioning to Bob earlier that my wife came in and picked it up on her phone as well. She wanted me to see it as well. So it was obviously making the rounds. And, of course, part of the reason was that Democrats were more than happy to let people throughout the nation know that there are these wacko nutcases out there that are still doing this. But I would suggest to you that there would be nothing that would require this unless there was kind of an innate feeling that maybe we ought to go back to something like slavery anyway. And given the fact that we happen to have an African-American president, and given the fact that the Tea Party's very existence is in large part a result of that fact, I would suggest to you that that would go a long way to helping us understand exactly where Representative Wheeler may be coming from. Speaking of that, and again, I'm not looking for subtle shifts or transitions here necessarily, but I think I found one. Before getting into yesterday, I mentioned the fact that our second hour would be much more substantive than the first, and it was to a point, but it wasn't nearly. I didn't get into the substance that I wanted to, which was at least one and perhaps two Federalist Papers, and we'll do that today. But before I do that, there was an article in the Washington Post yesterday, a feature story about West Virginia. And I read it, and obviously a lot of other people read it, because when I looked at it, if you read the entire article and went all the way to the bottom, at the end of the article on the internet were comments. And at that point, when I looked at this yesterday afternoon, there were 1,665 comments to this article. And I started to read some of them, and of course I'm located in West Virginia. My wife was born and raised here in West Virginia, and I've lived here a good portion of my life, and to be honest with you, the best portion. And that's not too good to say on the night that the Red Sox are playing for the World Series championship, is it? But I did have some good experience in Boston as well. But anyway, back to the point. I started to read some of these comments, and what I found, very honestly, that the comments in many ways were more striking and more revealing than was the article itself. And I haven't been able to get it out of my mind, to the point that I, last evening after we went off the air, I asked my wife to come in and bring up the New York Times on the internet and read the article for herself. And of course she came back into the kitchen and was just ranting and raving about the article. And I said, did you look at any of the comments? And she said, no, I didn't know to. And it so happened that I had printed off, you know, page and a half or so of the first, from the first group of comments. I read comments for about 10 minutes on that article, and I was just blown away. Every one seemed more quotable than the one before it. And what I realized was that this article had touched so many sensitive spots out there. And of course, you know, the gist of the conversation is that, you know, I mean, these issues that this article raised are so, West Virginians are so sensitive to these issues. But the fact of the matter is many of these comments were not coming from West Virginians at all. They were coming from people around the rest of the nation who read the Washington Post, and they were comments that were engendered by an article on West Virginia, but they weren't necessarily West Virginians. In fact, some of the comments that I saw, when they came from a West Virginian, usually it was very obvious. The author of the comment would basically say, I'm in the state, or I used to be in the state, or I was born in the state, or something. So they would almost identify themselves as a West Virginia resident, or a previous West Virginia resident, before they made their comment. So that kind of told me that the bulk of these articles were not from people in West Virginia, but outside. And one of the things I was struck with was the vitriol, the hostility, the negativism, the out-and-out hate that's generated on some of these issues. And one of them, very honestly, is the fact that the President of the United States is, how do they say it, different than what we would expect the president to be like. And nobody will ever say it. One of the comments that I put down says the following. I'm going to read it directly because I think it makes the point I'm making here right now. And the comment says the following. You know, there is just something about this particular Democratic president that's different than the others. I can't quite put my finger on it. He just seems, you know, different, unlike the others. Can anyone help me out here? What is it that makes Obama so different? And the first response he gets is this. Yes, he's even more incompetent than the rest of them all put together. And I think what that does is give you a flavor for how much conversation there is out there in people who, if they don't have to sign their name, or they can sign a name different than their own, if they have an internet or an email or a Twitter handle, if you will, then that seems to free them up to say things that they might not say to anybody's face because they wouldn't want to be pinned down on it or wouldn't want to be quoted on it. Unbelievable stuff. The article was about the extent to which West Virginia is rapidly moving more and more out of the column of blue states into the column of red states. And there's no question that President Obama has speeded up that process, if it needed speeding up at all. There's absolutely no question there is a tremendous sense of hostility in West Virginia to Washington, to the president, obviously to the EPA, to the Environmental Protection Agency, because the belief is that Washington is engaged in a war on coal, which is costing coal jobs and literally costing people their very way of life in this area. The headline in this morning's paper here in West Virginia was about a demonstration that was held in Washington yesterday, and our own local representative, Nick Rahal, is quoted extensively in that article, and he's talking about the war on coal. So I've known Nick Rahal for a number of years, and I personally like him, and I think overall he's been a very, very good representative for a lot of reasons. He's been good for the area. He worked very, very well with Senator Byrd when Senator Byrd was alive. But I think that it's very obvious that Congressman Rahal is facing a challenge in this next election, next fall, next November, that's probably stronger and more serious than any challenge he's faced before. He could lose his seat. And if I'm not mistaken, he's been reelected 18 times. He's been in the Congress, you know, more than 35 years. And he took an active role in this demonstration yesterday and spoke on behalf of West Virginians and against the EPA and against President and against Washington and all the rest of it. And, you know, he's in a very, very difficult political position because the people in his constituency, this is coal country, and the people in his constituency believe that they are the victims of a conscious effort to destroy their way of life coming out of Washington. Now, the fact of the matter is, part of the reason they believe that is because there's one of the most carefully orchestrated, well-funded campaigns being conducted here in West Virginia by a group called the Friends of Coal. And they have been able to fashion themselves as friends of the state and friends of the citizens of the state, when in fact, as representatives of the coal companies themselves, these people are concentrating on directing the hatred and the bitterness and the vitriol and the vindictiveness of the people in this community toward Washington in order to divert it away from themselves. Because the fact of the matter is, the loss of coal jobs began long before this administration came into office. And the loss of coal jobs in this state, and especially in this region, has been not only the result of technology. And the number of coal jobs that have disappeared in West Virginia since President Reagan was elected, when I came to West Virginia in the early 90s, at that time people were talking about the state was losing jobs over the last 10 years since 1980. The point was that up until 1980, there were in excess of 125,000 jobs in West Virginia directly related to coal. And that number was rapidly declining. I mean, I saw this in the media when I first came here in the early 90s. And the jobs were disappearing because technology and other factors related to coal, the fact that, you know, that there was some need to worry about the environmental impact and the quality of the air and all that associated with coal, as well as the waste. And if you may remember, in the early 70s, in 1972, coal country West Virginia experienced something called the Buffalo Creek disaster, where that coal slurry dam had broke free and this horrendous black flood water had flooded the area, and the path of destruction and death was incredible. So that, you know, that there's obviously a history here. But the point I'm trying to make is that while we are much more interested today in environmental protection, and the EPA is indeed carrying out the will of most of the people of the country in terms of finding a way to clean up air, and I think the classic example of this is the situation that existed in China last week when we saw pictures in the media of the air being so poor and visibility being so bad in the cities of northern China that people were going around in masks and they couldn't drive because they couldn't even see the front of their car. The visibility was so bad. And the fact of the matter is what we were looking at, in a sense, was what coal without regulation when there is no EPA, what the result is. And so, you know, I think it was it's a very, very dramatic period. And the combination of that plus the transition to natural gas and you know, the Marcellus Shale situation and the securing of this gas from deep down in the earth is making natural gas so plentiful that it's also inhibiting the expansion and the growth of coal. And the combination of that plus the air quality standards that have been created is really creating an economic crisis here in West Virginia. There's absolutely no question. And it's creating a problem for people like Congressman Rahal and others, because at the same they want to be out there representing the best interests of their constituents and their region. But the fact of the matter is you've got to look at the realities of today's world, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So it's much more complicated than that. Anyway, that's what the article was about. And the article was about how increasingly a state which used to vote straight Democratic, and of course the stories about Senator Kennedy launching his campaign in West Virginia in the 1960 election campaign, and are very, very prominent here in southern West Virginia in coal country. And so there's an awful lot associated with this. And so in a sense, it's very, very, I think it's very revealing to be here and to see all of this happening around. But I know so many people who have earned it. I mean, everybody you talk to, my father was a coal miner, my uncle was a coal miner, my brothers are coal miners, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, coal touches so many people's lives in this area that it's going to take a long, long time before that connection is severed.
Hey, Dr.
Hey, Doctor.
Yes, Bob.
I thought I'd let you know that you've got Jeff on the line for you.
Okay, thank you, Bob.
All right, stand by. I'll bring him aboard.
Thank you very much. Hello, Jeff.
How are you? I know I haven't called in. I've been listening to you for on and off for quite a bit, but it's not just West Virginia that's turning to red states. I'm listening to this in Cincinnati, Ohio, and Florida, it's a blame game. They want to blame the president for a lousy economy. It has nothing to do with. I mean, if you were brought up as a cannibal, and that's how you were brought up, it's not the fault of the people who are blaming. It's the way the system systemically is set up.
I understand. Yeah.
So the point is, it's not just happening in West Virginia. This is happening all over the world. It's happening. You know, I'm in New York State, which is a blue state. I mean, this is outrageous to see. And I'm a Democratic town. I mean, they think Obama is the worst thing that would happen. And you can't, and it's almost impossible to argue it. And they say, look how bad the economy is. It's Obama's fault. No, it's not. It's been going bad for 40 years, man. But now it's just starting to show. How can we even justify blaming? I mean, we have to step back and say, what is going on here? Yeah. It's not, and you can't blame the individual. I mean, I realize.
There's always a tendency and a need on the part of people to find find somebody to blame, or some group to blame, or some event to blame, or something. You know, the whole idea of going back to Hitler, the idea of finding a scapegoat for Germany's problems and pinning it on the Jews and pinning it on the communists and on the gays was a strategy that worked. It gave
people,
a place to focus their hate.
Well, the problem is, look, someone said to me, history is always repeating itself. And it certainly does repeat itself, because we're not changing anything about history.
No.
The reality is that 200 years ago, if I told you that we were going to change history with a computer, and you can sit in your living room and do a radio show, you would have laughed your ass off.
That's exactly right.
We've changed history because of our technology.
And it's changing. It's continuing to change all the time.
Well, that's the problem. It can't possibly change until we say human beings are, in fact, valuable. It is not fair for a human being to sell their soul or their life or their health for X amount of dollars. It is
right.
not fair for another human being to say, those people aren't worth the powder to blow to hell, they're expendable. It's not humane. And I don't give a damn if you're a Republican or a Democrat. If you talk to honest Republicans and honest Democrats, they're saying the same damn thing.
Right.
And I think that Republicans at one point in time were a certain breed, and Democrats were another breed. But right now, I can't see much difference in them. I've known Chuck Schumer for a long time. He's a Democrat. If you look at what Obama did, he's dead middle. He's not hard left. I mean, I'm an Obama fan, by the way. I mean, don't get me wrong. I'm an independent, but I'm an Obama fan. But I talked to my friends who were anti-Obama, and they said, "How can you vote? How can you vote from twice? How can you vote for?" So my answer to that was, "How do you vote for Bush twice?" That's not the point. I just got into a limited hangout when I said that to them. We need to focus. Look, you've been watching history. You're a history professor. You're amazingly talented. I mean, why can't we say there was a time when the Republicans and Democrats were separate and they stood for something? But not now.
No.
Not now. There's no way we're going to be able to keep on dividing this country back and up and down. We have to figure out a way to help all humanity out, including foreign countries. So I'm not asking you to come up with a solution, but I think it would be a nice topic of conversation.
I understand what you're saying. And basically what you're talking about is a rebirth of the idea of humanism as being something that is positive rather than something that is negative because it's in some ways anti-Christian or anti-God something.
Well, when I give a talk, I try now to say there are several different, you know, I'm 6'10", and I'm 110 pounds, and I say, what's wrong with these measurements? And then, of course, the group, they all laugh, and they think I'm kidding. And then I say, okay, now we have isms. We have communism, capitalism, and cannibalism.
Yeah.
If we also have something called humanitarianism, how can we put certain things together that work? And then I go to the next phase. So the point is we need to get away from Democrat-Republican concepts. We need to change the very face of the economic system. And I'm not suggesting my ways work, but I know we need to go back over where it first started. You know, I listened to Kincaid the other day, and he went way back. He went to the pharaohs and or something similar to that. How are you going to? We must go further back than just the Constitution. There's something systemically wrong. Anyway, I emailed a couple of things about. Anyway, I'll let you go. But
thanks, Jeff. Thank you, and I appreciate because I really think that what you're saying is what all of us really are about. And what I'm guessing that what you're basically suggesting is that the system tends to be organized against an effort to do exactly what you're saying needs to be done. And I understand that. And I don't disagree with it. I think we need to rediscover the beauty of humanity, of what being a human being means. And, you know, those who are really into the – I don't mean people who majored in a subject within the concept of the liberal arts, but real humanists throughout the generations in the liberal arts have been committed to that for a long time. But very honestly, you are right. They haven't done a very good job. And part of the reason is I don't think they really realize the importance of what they represent, what they reflect. And so while they talk about it, they talk about it in terms and in ways that that they communicate well with each other, but they don't communicate with the community at large. My position has been here that the whole reason for something like the virtual center is because I believe that's one of the major problems with America's general understanding of the founders and the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence and everything else. I don't think there's really an understanding of it. And part of the reason is, it's the same reason, there are vested interests who see their best strategy as being opposed to doing that. Just as in West Virginia, there's a group that I mentioned earlier called the Friends of Coal, who have a vested interest in directing the hatred and all the problems and associated with what's happening in this part of the country economically because of what they call a war on coal, is directing all of that vitriol and all that hate towards Washington and specifically towards the president. There's absolutely no question. The president has got to be more unpopular in West Virginia than almost anywhere else. I mean, the polls are incredible. So, anyway.
But the thing is, the reason why this is taking place is because Howard Zinn he does great work, and his basic premise is there's something systemically wrong with not just the country, with the entire way the economic system works. If you'll hear Howard Zinn speak, of course, I'm so sorry he's gone, but I play his stuff all the time for people. It's just great work. He doesn't come up with an answer either, but he knows, and we all know, there's something systemically wrong, and it's not just within this 300 years or 200 years of our country. It's been from the very beginning of man. So anyway, I'll let you go, but keep up the good work.
Thank you, Jeff. Thank you, buddy. I appreciate it. Anyway, I wanted to share a couple of these comments from the bottom of this article, just to give you a flavor for what an article like this can generate in a major publication like the Washington Post or the New York Times or the LA Times or the Boston Globe or the Chicago Tribune or whatever, the Guardian or whatever you're talking about. So here, just a couple of these for. Just to pick up the not only the content but the tone, just the tone of the language, I think it tells us an awful lot. Here's one: the people are not without blame. The state has one of the highest rates of unwed teenage mothers on welfare. They produce generation after generation of emotionally immature adults. The state has a high illiteracy rate. The families do not place value on education. The state is a criminal gang gone wild. The Klan system that takes care of their own. The people are savage. I live here by choice, and I found that particular comment extremely offensive. But on the other hand, there are people who make money by portraying West Virginians that way, and they basically go under rocks and into caves and everything else to find people that will fit that image so they can continue to say it. This one is a little bit more substantive and a little bit less crazy, if you will, but I think the content is significant. I think the person who wrote this obviously has a fairly good handle on some of the things that are really going on in West Virginia. A huge omission from this article is the part played by Friends of Coal, an industry organization that has conducted an expensive and unrelenting campaign that squarely places blame for the coal industry's woes in West Virginia on President Obama and his so-called war on coal. The coal industry has spent millions on television and radio ads, billboards, and public opinion programs to convince West Virginians that Obama and the EPA are out to destroy the industry, when the truth is cheap natural gas and depletion of the best and most easily mined coal reserves is the reason for big coal's decline. Further, a substantial amount of coal mined in West Virginia is metallurgical and is shipped off to China and India, where to my knowledge, the EPA has no authority. Also missing in a discussion of land ownership in West Virginia. Excuse, let me go back. Also missing is a discussion of land ownership in West Virginia. In the southern coal counties, out-of-state corporations like Norfolk Southern own upwards of 85 and 90% of the land. Blessed with negligible taxes, they have no need or desire to part with any of their basically tax-free investments, thus assuring that there can be no diversification of the economy through manufacturing or other industries. In fact, it is in their interest to see that there is no diversification and that the areas are depopulated. People get in the way of destructive practices like mountaintop removal mining, which are by nature gigantic operations. Furthermore, by limiting jobs to $100,000 a year mining jobs versus employment flipping burgers for $15,000 a year, the coal industry guarantees itself a loyal and militant workforce. Without going into detail and making comment on that, the only thing I would say is I needed to read it twice because at first I thought I wrote it. Because over the years that I've been here, that's pretty much what I see. Here's another one. What's up with West Virginia? Most blue states seem to enjoy the record poverty, record unemployment, massive deficit spending, record debt, record middle class decline, and labor force shrinkage the Democratic Party wrought with them and vote to get more of the same. So this is obviously something that is pointing out that West Virginians deserve what they get because they've been voting Democrat for so long. A continuation of that theme. West Virginia has an extremely high number of people applying for and receiving SSDI. In many cases, approvals are granted based upon what lawyer is acting for the applicant. Lawyers are getting rich off this scheme while the disability side of Social Security is losing money. So these folks are unhappy with Democrats. What's going to happen when Republicans take over and cut the program benefits in half? Here's somebody from West Virginia, and this raises the issue of religion. I just think that there's so much substance, and the tone here is so revealing. As someone who grew up in and still has many friends and family in the state, I think the root of the conversion to red lies in the churches. There are congregations where the pastor openly preaches about why this or that aspect of our current political scene spells signs of the end times, how Obama is the Antichrist. Also, the state has always been fairly socially conservative, and with the loss of mining jobs, which they blame not on modernization or on economic factors like the cheap price of natural gas, but rather on the government, they're much less unionized than they once were, and they just aren't the traditional democratic support structures in place any longer. People would much rather blame the government for their ills than the fact that times have changed. Finally, it never ceases to amaze me that so many West Virginians turn a completely blind eye to the mega-wealthy mine owners who don't care a whit about their employees' safety or welfare. And the comments just go on like that. And so basically what this article revealed and unsurfaced is all of this vitriol and all of this hatred, not just from West Virginians, but from other people who read this. And one of the things that I noticed, and I wanted to point it out because I want you to notice it from here on in, one of the things that I've learned about West Virginia and its history is that West Virginia has been a great place for people who live elsewhere to tell people in this state what they ought to do, how they ought to live, what they ought to believe, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. In other words, the one thing about West Virginia, it's almost like education. It's almost like schools. Everybody went to school, so everybody's an expert. Everybody knows how to fix the education system. And somehow West Virginia has fallen into that, you know, into that status. Everybody knows West Virginia. Everybody knows Appalachia. We remember the birth of Vista and all the rest of it, and all of these well-meaning good people from around the country who were willing to volunteer their time and give up a year to help the poor people of Appalachia. everybody seems to know what's wrong here. Everybody's got an opinion. And everybody can find a way to blame what's happening or what has happened or is happening here on something else that is happening somewhere else, usually Washington. My wife tells a story, because she was born and raised right here in southern West Virginia. She tells a story about when the federal government came in here as part of the effort to help poor West Virginians with you know, largesse programs, programs that have become almost expected, things like food stamps and welfare and all of these things, that a lot of people, you know, believe that they knew. I mean, that's one of the negative things about the 1960s that I can recall, is that we became, you know, awfully outspoken do-gooders. We basically knew what was wrong with everybody in the world, and we knew how to fix it. We were more than willing to go tell people, you need to eat better, you need to stop smoking, you need to stop drinking, you need to get a night's sleep, you need to do this, you need to do that, etc. And so instead of teaching people how to take care of themselves or helping people to equip themselves to take care of themselves, what happened, and this is kind of my wife's mantra, she talks about this over and over, she's not wrong, is that what happened is that people who were independent suddenly became extremely dependent on help from a number of different outside agencies and directions. And the result was that West Virginians not only became economically, were no longer just economically in need, they also lost this sense of independence and their self-confidence, their ability to fix their own problems and take it on. And I think that's a real issue. I think that's a real issue. And a lot of people, a lot of the older folks that I've talked to in this region will go back to the 30s and 40s and some of these programs, especially, you know, if you look in the rearview mirror, so to speak. But anyway, the vitriol and the hostility, I couldn't resist sharing this with you here at the virtual center. We're at 48 minutes after the hour, and I wanted to, in fact, yesterday I was going to, and I want to try to follow through on that. And this is the area, the issue of substance. I've mentioned numerous times in the past the value of and the need to really be able to get our arms around the Federalist Papers and what historically the Federalist Papers have become for a lot of people. My sense is that a lot of people who claim, we talked about this the other day, a lot of people who claim that they read the Federalist Papers really haven't, because very honestly, not only are they deadly, and a lot, they're very extremely complex and extremely difficult to understand. But anyway, there are a couple of papers that I wanted to focus on. We've done a lot. We've looked carefully here at the Virtual Center at Federalist No. 9, Federalist No. 10, and Federalist No. 51. We've spent a lot of time with those documents. I've also made reference, although we haven't really looked at the document per se, and we can do that in a future program, to Federalist 58. And what makes Federalist 58 significant today is this conversation, this controversy that has surfaced about the not only the negatives but the positives of minority government. The realization, the position that many people take, that there are so many people who are participating in political decision-making in this country that not only have no knowledge of what's going on, but have no interest in what's going on. And yet they are being encouraged and browbeaten and everything else to go out and vote on issues that they really don't know anything about. And so consequently, what we need to do is find a way to separate knowledgeable voters from ignorant voters. That what we need to do is go back to the idea that voting is not a right, it's a privilege. And those people who recognize that it's a privilege and take it seriously and really do their homework, so to speak, are the people that we want to be involved in political decision making. The others we won't miss. And this sense, this mentality, is in large part behind what's happening in many states to restrict and limit and minimize the turnout at elections by curtailing early voting, requiring photo IDs and other things in order to demonstrate and prove that one is entitled to vote. And of course, the criticism of this is that the people that this hurts, of course, are the people who would be voting Democrat. And these programs are being pushed by Republicans. And if you may recall, within the last year, there were people caught on tape, on video, acknowledging members of state legislature. Can you remember the Republican legislator from Pennsylvania who made the point that by passing a photo ID legislation in Pennsylvania, what had they had effectively done is eliminate several hundred thousand Democratic voters by doing this. And so there's no question that while all the arguments are couched in patriotism and nationalism and sincerity and virtue and all the rest of it, the fact of the matter is the motives that are driving this are very obviously political. And consequently, there has been more and more conscious effort to try to justify the idea of minority voting in America. And where Federalist 58 has become prominent of late is that James Madison himself in Federalist 58 addresses the idea of minority government. Because many people who are in the minority during that period in the 1780s believe the same thing, that part of the problem with government under the Confederation in the states was, as Madison says, decisions are being made not according to justice or to the rights of the minority party, but by the superior and overbearing power of majorities. So in other words, people whose only interest is their own self-interest have unified and gotten together and are having their day, as it will, in our states. And so consequently, many of the minorities in these states, many of those that Madison called the most considerate and virtuous citizens, began to argue the idea of minority government. Why don't we just let the people who really know and are interested and will do a good job, why don't we let them participate, let them vote, and try to find ways to eliminate these other people who are only trying to feather their own beds and benefit their own self-interest. They don't care about the public, about other people, about the future of the country, the future of the state or the economy or anything else. All they care about is themselves. And that becomes a justification in the 1780s and on the part of many people for minority government, letting minorities, giving people who are worth so much more income or money or property than others double the vote rather than single vote, for example. The state of Maryland during the Confederation period, that was the state that I did most of my research in, the state of Maryland actually debated legislation which would have denied attorneys the right to vote or run for office. You can think about that if you look at Congress today. The whole Congress would be gone. The argument was that attorneys are the ones who write the laws, and so it's a conflict of interest to turn to the very same people to represent constituencies, to represent the people who wrote the laws and wrote them in such a way that they will directly benefit from them. We need to get rid of these people from the political process, not encourage them to participate more actively in it. So Maryland actually debated legislation to deny voting and office holding to attorneys. A lot of people who, I remember when I reported that in seminar one time, a lot of my graduate student colleagues believed that that was a great idea. We ought to take that and basically work it through at many of our state legislatures today. But anyway, so the point was that Madison himself in Federalist No. 58 acknowledged a sense of understanding or appreciation as to why so many good people were saying this. But then Madison pointed out the dangers of minority government, that ultimately, if you set up a system that clearly is minority government, then what you are doing in the process is denying majority rule. You're denying to the vast majority of your people an opportunity to gain power, that part of equality that our nation stands for is the right to do that. Of course, Madison in the Constitution sets up a system which is going to make that, he believes, impossible. But it's one thing to make it impossible to be effective. It's another thing to straight up in black and white to deny people the opportunity to even participate in the political process. In other words, Madison's argument is that what you'd be doing would be endorsing minority government, and if you did that, you would be effectively destroying any illusion at all that this nation is abiding by Republican principles. There has been a rebirth today on the part of many people, especially Tea Party people, about returning by limiting, by voter IDs and various other things, by minimizing and streamlining the electorate in such a way that we really get down to the hard core of really good, committed, sincere citizens. And of course, they believe that if they do that, the majority of the party in power will be eliminated. So so not only have we done 9 and 10 and 51 here at the Virtual Center, but we've made reference more than one occasion to Federalist 58. What I want to do, and we're a couple of minutes before the top of the hour, so we'll pause and take our break. But what I want to do when we come back is I want to begin to look, first of all, at Federalist number 1, the very first Federalist paper written by Alexander Hamilton. I think it's overlooked. It's overlooked as because it's the introduction to a series of 84 more, people tend to downplay or to disregard the substance of Federalist number 1, when in fact it is extremely substantive. It's not that long, and it won't take that long to cover it, but I think it's very important that we do, because included in it is Hamilton's introduction for what is to follow, which is a series of papers defending the Constitution that was developed in Philadelphia in the year before, in 1787. And then once that is over, I'd like to go to Federalist number 39. Federalist number 39 is written by James Madison, and it's on the nature of Republican government. What James Madison does in 59 is take on the challenge of anti-federalists who are criticizing the Constitution because it destroys the very principles of Republican government as they know it. And so Madison's strategy, Madison's challenge in Federalist 39 is to basically convince people that we are not in the Constitution, we are not destroying or jeopardizing Republican government in America. In effect, we're strengthening it. So that's the direction I'd like to go in. We'll begin that in our second hour, but we have reached the top of our first hour, and we've had a caller. I want to thank Jeff for calling and sharing his ideas and points of view, not only with me but with everybody tuned in. So we'll pause for 4 or 5 minutes here, and then we'll come right back, and we'll launch into hour number two, and we'll begin to look at Alexander Hamilton's very first Federalist paper. I'm Bill O'Brien. You're listening to the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. After a short break, we'll be right back. Please stay with us. Thank you, Bob Kincaid, and welcome back to the Virtual Center for the Study. I forgot where it was there for a minute. Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution. I'm Bill O'Brien. We're into our second hour. If you've been with us through the first hour, I want to thank you for staying with us. If you're just joining us, welcome. And I will tell you right up front that you are going to be exposed in this hour to the Federalist Papers. We're going to begin with the very first one, Hamilton's Federalist Paper, and depending on how long it takes us to get through that, then we'll begin to look at number 39. These are significant, as I mentioned just prior to the top of the hour. Hamilton's number one, the very first Federalist Paper, is rarely looked at, rarely considered, and I think most people think, well, there are 85 papers, that what's the first one except an introduction saying, here comes a whole bunch more. But in fact, there's some substantive information in the first Federalist Paper that I think is very important in terms of understanding the ones that follow. And the second paper, number 39, is very important because in that one, Madison sets out to prove that the new Constitution is not contradictory to republicanism, but is in fact an extension of it and a way to strengthen it. And I think it's a very, very important paper. I think we'll find that it's a very complex and difficult one to get our arms around. I want to spend a little bit of time on that. Not that I'm going to clarify complexity. I'm not sure I can do that. But I can. I think I can add a little bit to our understanding as to the complexity itself. Our phone number is area code 304-658-3333. And our email address is, my email address is waobrien906@gmail.com. So again, without any further introduction then, let me share with you some thoughts and some commentary on the Federalist Papers, beginning with number one. I think it's very significant to appreciate the fact that this campaign was a long one. Of course, 85 editorials in support of the Constitution takes some time, at least 85 days. Even if you had a paper coming out every day, you'd have 85 days. Most of the newspapers during this period were weekly or every other day. Sometimes they came out two or three times a week. But they weren't, as I recall, they weren't dailies, if that makes sense. And this one, this very first paper, appeared in the Independent Journal in New York on Saturday, October 27th, 1787. It's important to realize the Constitutional Convention adjourned. The last day of the convention was September 17th, 1787. This first Federalist Paper is October 27th, a month and 10 days after the adjournment of the convention. It's addressed to the people of the state of New York, as are all the Federalist Papers. So this whole series is focused on the ratification process in New York. Doesn't happen until late summer 1788. The campaign begins in October of 1787. I think that's very significant. This is a long process. I think it speaks to how serious these people took it. The author of number one is Alexander Hamilton, and that's very understandable. Alexander Hamilton was a New Yorker. He was a prominent politico in New York, very influential. He had been a member of the Constitutional Convention from the state of New York. He was a representative at the convention from New York. And basically, he is addressing this first paper as the beginning of a process that he is clearly anticipating to be a long one and an ongoing one. And so he opens by saying to the people of the state of New York, after an unequivocal experience of the inefficiency of the subsisting federal government, you are being called upon to deliberate on a new constitution of the United States of America. So he lays or starts right off by telling the people, you know, after a long, unquestioned, not debatable, negative experience with the existing federal government, you're being asked to consider a whole different approach. The subject, he said, speaks its own importance, comprehending in its consequences nothing less than the existence of the Union, the safety and welfare of the parts of which it is composed, the fate of an empire in many respects the most interesting in the world. So Hamilton lays out the not the goals. Hamilton lays out the serious nature of this effort. He points out that this issue of this new constitution literally deals with nothing less than the very existence of the Union itself. The welfare and the safety of the people in the parts of that union, which are the states, and the future fate of an empire that in many respects holds promise to being something very important in the world to come. So Hamilton opens up the debate, opens up the Federalist Papers by laying out exactly what the stakes are. And then he says something that I mentioned, that there are a number of substantive comments in here, things that we ought to know that are significant. And I think his next sentence, and I'm not going to go through every sentence of this document, but I've identified here on my own copy a number of sentences which I believe are very significant, and the next one is one of those. He points out, it has been frequently remarked that it seems to have been reserved to the people of this country by their conduct and example to decide the important question whether societies of men are really capable or not of establishing good government from reflection and choice, or whether they are forever destined to depend for their political constitutions on accident and force. This is a very, very important point that I think Hamilton is telling people right out of the chute. And he's saying to people, this is unique in the history of the world. Up until this point, most people, in the kind of governments they have had to deal with what they're handed, what's been given them either by accident or by force. This is the first time that people have actually been given the chance to choose the kind of government under which they will be governed. That's unheard of in the history of the world. John Adams makes that point in one of his letters as well. So I can't tell you whether this originates with Adams or originates with Hamilton. But it's a very important point. This is a unique opportunity for man in the history of the world. No people has ever been given the authority to design their own political structure. I mean, you go all the way back to the Mayflower Compact, which kind of does that. But in a sense, this is very, very unique. And then he starts talking about the challenges or the obstacles we face in trying to do this. And I'm skipping what in the copy I have is an entire paragraph. He talks about patriotism and philanthropy and the idea of connecting to the public good. He mentions a number of things about the need to have an open discussion devoid of passions and prejudices, as we seek to together to discover the truth. I mean, that's really what he's talking about what these papers, these Federalist Papers, are all about. And then he says, and this I think is a very significant paragraph, among the most formidable of the obstacles which the new Constitution will have to encounter may readily be distinguished the obvious interest of a certain class of men in every state to resist all changes which may hazard a diminution of the power, emolument, and consequence of the offices they hold under the state establishments. So what he's pointing out here is that this new Constitution, besides the fact that it's unprecedented in the history of the world, one of the obstacles it's going to face is that there are principal key positioned men in every state who have a vested interest in not changing anything. Because in doing so, their power, their income, and the opportunities that the offices that they hold in their states provide them make it clear that they have a vested interest in nothing changing. So somehow, to get this thing through, we're going to have to deal with this kind of opposition. And then he goes on and mentions something else that is an obstacle: the perverted ambition of another class of men who will either hope to aggrandize themselves by the confusion of their country or will flatter themselves with fairer prospects of elevation from the subdivision of the empire into several partial confederacies than from its union under one government. He's pointing out to another obstacle. This might be one of the more substantive pieces of information contained in Federalist No. 1, because what Hamilton is pointing to here are those opponents of the Constitution. And here it is, the 27th of October, only a month and 10 days out from the convention, and already Hamilton knows that there are prominent people in each state who are going to fight this tooth and nail. He already knows it. He saw it in the convention. And one of the things people are talking about, he says, is dividing up the Union into several partial confederacies, using their commitment to the idea of republican government, using their loyalty to the teachings and the ideas of Montesquieu, to support the idea that in order to preserve republican government, we don't need one union of all 13 states. What makes much more sense is to divide the Union up into regional confederacies, having a southern union, a central state or middle state union, and a union of the New England states. And many of the anti-federalists are talking about this and saying there's so much disparity between New England and the South, and between the middle states and the South, and the middle states and New England, why not just go with what's obvious? Why not just take each independent region and allow it to be its own freestanding confederacy, rather than going all the way to try to create a union of all 13. Hamilton sees this as a major danger, because it is. What the opponents of the Constitution are doing is they are using people's commitment to republicanism and Montesquieu's argument that republics must be small in order to work as a justification for challenging the Constitution by suggesting that we can fix the articles, we can reform some of the problems that government faces without going all the way to a union or to a consolidation of some national government, that what we can do instead is break the Union up into regional confederacies. Hamilton sees that as the, not only Hamilton, but the leaders of the Federalist movement, Madison is also, they see this as a real danger, because it's a very appealing argument. If you think about it, it makes a lot of sense. because the argument is the regions are so much alike internally and so much unalike when you match one up against the other, that it would seem to make more sense that Republican government would be much more comfortable in regional confederacies because they would be so alike. It seems to make perfect sense, and the Federalists are really worried about this. And, of course, at this point, in Federalist number one, we don't know why. We'll find that out in the later papers. But we know, from having already looked at Federalist 51 and Federalist 10, we know that the goal here is not to find a way to make Republican government work better. The goal here is to accomplish something much different than that, to create a situation where decisions over government policy are made by the right people by finding a way to exclude the wrong people. And in order to pull that off, you're going to have the total union. You're not going to be able to do it in regional confederacies. So Hamilton, right out of the chute, in the very first page of the very first essay, makes it very clear that this idea of regional confederacies is something we're going to have to deal with in order to get this Constitution through. And then he goes on and after that and talks about how we need to realize that some of the opponents of the Constitution are honest, good people. I would expect that Hamilton probably believes this. I don't think that he's lying. But I also think it's politically a very good thing to do is to acknowledge the sincerity and the commitment of your opponents. It's a good strategy. So what Hamilton is doing is setting up the opposition by saying to them, in effect, we know that some of you are really honest, good people who really believe that what you're arguing for is for the best interest of the nation, is in the public interest. But we're here to tell you and show you why that's not true. But what you do is you soften up your opponents by going out of your way to concede their sincerity and their commitment and their honesty and their goodwill. And then you basically hit them right in the jugular, if that makes sense. But he basically makes the point that while this is true, that there are many good people out there that are opposed to this, he makes the point there are also good people who, you know, there are a lot of bad people who are supporting it. We need to be aware that it's not cut and dried. It's not clear cut. But then he talks about the people that you really need to be careful of. And he said, so numerous indeed and so powerful are the causes which serve to give a false bias to the judgment that we, upon many occasions, see wise and good men on the wrong as well as on the right side of questions of the first magnitude in society. In other words, the issues here that we're going to be dealing with are so passionate, people are so passionate, they are so important, that what we're going to end up seeing is wise and good men on the wrong side as well as the right side. In other words, you can't say here that all the bright people are on one side and all the stupid people are on the other side. You can't say that, he says. They're going to be wise and good people, good men on both sides. But then he gets into the fact that all the people on the other side are not good people. And here's what he says. Ambition, avarice, personal animosity, party opposition, and many other motives not more laudable than these are apt to operate as well upon those who support as those who oppose the right side of the question. And again, he's still clarifying that you can't answer this issue, you can't resolve this issue solely by looking at who's for it and who's against it. It's more complicated than that. Basically, what he's saying is there are ambitious, avaricious people on both sides of the question, and we need to realize this. Ambition, avarice, personal animosity, party opposition, and many other motives not more laudable than these. In other words, other reasons even worse are apt to operate as well on those who support as those who oppose the right side of the question. So his point is there's a right side, which is the new Constitution. And what he's pointing out is good people are opposed to it as well as bad. And he also points out that there are ambitious, self-interested people on both sides. So you can't make the distinction that way. He says, for in politics, as in religion, it's equally absurd to aim at making proselytes by fire and sword. Heresies in either can rarely be cured by persecution. What he's saying is that what we've got to do is we've got to lay out exactly what the issues are. Then he goes through what, and he goes into what I think is a very, very significant paragraph in this first Federalist paper. He says, to judge from the conduct of the opposite parties, we shall be led to conclude that they will mutually hope to evince the justness of their opinions and to increase the number of their converts by the loudness of their declarations and the bitterness of their invectives. I mean, what beautifully written English this is. It's absolutely beautiful stuff. Now he's crediting the quality of the opposition. And he says, to judge from the conduct of the opposite parties, we shall be led to conclude that they will mutually hope to evince the justness of their opinions and to increase the number of their commerce, the converts. In other words, they're going to go out and try to appeal to people by the loudness of their declamations and the bitterness of their invectives. They're going to take this on and they're going to really make it tough for us. And we got to be prepared for that. He goes on, an enlightened zeal for the energy and the efficiency of government will be stigmatized as the offspring of a temper fond of despotic power and hostile to the liberty, to the principles of liberty. What he is basically saying here, telling his readers, is that these people are going to accuse us of horrible things. And so we've got our work cut out for us. What they're going to say is that our support for energy and efficiency in government is driven by a desire of for despotic power and hostile, and that we are hostile to the principles of liberty. They were going to accuse us of some bad things, Hamilton is saying. An over-scrupulous jealousy of danger to the rights of the people, which is more commonly the fault of the head than the heart, will be represented as mere pretense and artifice, the stale bait for popularity at the expense of the public good. It will be forgotten, on the one hand, he says, that jealousy is the usual concomitant of love, and that the noble enthusiasm of liberty is apt to be infected with a spirit of narrow and illiberal distrust. So we've got quite a challenge here. They're going to basically try to make you believe that our commitment and support for this system is in part how committed we are to destroying your liberties and your rights and your freedoms and the rest of it. On the other hand, he says, it will be equally forgotten that the vigor of government is essential to the security of liberty, that in the contemplation of a sound and well-informed judgment, their interests can never be separated, and that a dangerous ambition more often lurks behind the specious mask of zeal for the rights of the people than under the forbidden appearance of zeal for the firmness and efficiency of government. This sentence is loaded. He said, it will be forgotten. On the other hand, that the vigor of government is essential to the security of liberty. Stop and reflect on that one for a minute. Think about that line. What he's saying basically is individual liberty is not threatened by government, it's enhanced by government. The vigor of government is essential to the security of liberty. If government is strong and works, and if the political structure is stable and secure and predictable, if government is doing its job, people's freedom is enhanced, not limited. Hamilton is making an argument that I think all the Tea Party people today need to hear. Individual freedom is not gained at the expense of government, but because of it. And who else other than Alexander Hamilton says that? These are the founders talking. These are the people that created this system. So government is essential to the security of liberty. That in the contemplation of a sound and well-informed judgment, their interests can never be separated. In other words, you can never separate government and liberty. The two are interconnected. One depends on the other. And that a dangerous ambition more often lurks behind the specious mask of zeal for the rights of the people than under the forbidden appearance of zeal for the firmness and efficiency of government. What he's saying here is that those people who are out there pretending to care about the rights of the people are more dangerous than people who are out there arguing for the need for a strong, stable, workable government. You're going to be told to be careful of the latter, but you really need to be careful of the former. Be very careful about the people who are out there in front claiming that their only interest is your interest. Don't trust them. Because what they're going to do is they're going to attack those who are supporting this Constitution by suggesting that there's something anti-people and anti-freedom about agitating for more vigor and more strength and more power in government. So they're going to try to accuse us of that, but I'm trying to tell you that it's them that you need to be more careful of, not us. What a brilliant piece of writing this is. Well, I'll hold any comment. Let's finish this paragraph. History will teach us that the former, which are those people, those ambitious people who are out there claiming to represent or speak for the interests of the people, history will teach us that these people, these are the former, has been found a much more certain road to the introduction of despotism in the latter than the latter. And that of those men who have overturned the liberties of republics, the greatest number have begun their careers by paying an obsequious court to the people, commencing demagogues and ending tyrants. Wow. Now, this is like poetry. and what beautifully written stuff that this is. Listen to that. Let's listen to that sentence. History will teach us that the former has been found a much more certain road to the introduction of despotism than the latter. Those people who claim to represent the best interests of the people and their freedom throughout history have been the ones to be most worried about, most careful of. And that those men who have overturned the liberties of republics, those people that have literally brought down republics, for the most part, the greatest number, have begun their careers by paying an obsequious court to the people. In other words, by fashioning themselves as spokesmen for the people, commencing demagogues and ending up as tyrants. Ted Cruz. Is not Hamilton giving us a biographical sketch of Ted Cruz? Those people that get out there in front and scream and holler and disrupt government and shut down government and everything else and saying we're only doing it because this is what the American people want. And what Hamilton is saying is history has taught us that these people who have destroyed popular governments, who have destroyed republics in the past, have begun as champions of the people, have quite quickly surfaced as demagogues, and have ultimately, in many cases, ended up to be tyrants. What Hamilton has done in that paragraph, that's one of the most powerfully argued and well-written paragraphs that I've ever seen. What Hamilton is doing is he's basically going right at the opposition by saying in this article, they're going to basically tell you that we're the threat to your freedoms and your liberties and everything else. But history tells us that most often those are the people, the ones that are out there pretending to speak for the people, they're the ones you got to be afraid of. That's the political strategy of Federalist number one. I would suggest to you that's the political strategy of all 85 Federalist Papers, every one of them. And what we are gaining here in the very first Federalist Papers, the very first of 85 papers, is some insight into exactly the strategy that the Federalists are going to use in order to secure ratification of the Constitution in New York. Because Hamilton's got his finger on the pulse. He knows that there's an awful lot of opposition to the Constitution in New York. He knows that some of the most prominent people in the state are opposed to it. And it's going to be very difficult to get this thing through New York. And, of course, what he's going to find out is the same is true in many other states as well. Ratification's not a piece of cake anywhere by any stretch. Then he says, and he's bringing his first paper to a conclusion, and he says, in the course of the previous observations, I've had an eye, my fellow citizens, to putting you upon your guard against all attempts from whatever quarter to influence your decision in a matter of the utmost importance to your welfare by any impressions other than those which may result from the evidence of truth. In other words, what he's saying is, everything I've said for your own good. I'm basically going to the well, and I'm giving you truth, and I'm saying, truth tells us that you need to be careful of these things. That's what my purpose is. So basically what he's saying is, you can trust me. I've got your best interest at heart. In other words, he's doing exactly what he just criticized demagogues for doing in the past. He's telling the people, rest assured, I've got your best interest at heart. You can trust me. And that's exactly what the demagogues do. It's fabulous. And then at the conclusion of this first paper, first he's introducing the Federalist Papers themselves, and he's saying that this is the first of what's going to be a long train. He says, I propose in a series of papers to discuss the following interesting particulars: the utility of the Union to your political prosperity, the insufficiency of the present Confederation to preserving the Union, the necessity of a government at least equally energetic with the one proposed to the attainment of this object, the conformity of the proposed Constitution to the true principles of republican government, its analogy to your own state constitution, and lastly, the additional security which its adoption will afford to the preservation of that species of government, to liberty and to property. This is the preamble to the Federalist Papers. What Hamilton is doing is laying out the game plan. And he's saying, and this is at the conclusion of this first paper, I propose a series of papers that are going to address the following things: the utility of the Union to your political prosperity. In other words, the extent to which your future is dependent on the Union, on a solid Union. We're also going to address the insufficiency of the present Confederation to do that, because the present Confederation can't preserve the Union, and the Union is critical to your prosperity. One of the things that we plan to address in these papers, that I propose in these papers, is to point out the necessity, the need for a government that is at least as energetic as the Constitution proposed. In other words, what he's saying is the Constitution is just a minimum. We need a government that is at least as energetic and powerful as that one in order to attain this object of preserving the Union in order to guarantee your future prosperity. One of the things that I'll address in these papers is the link, the similarity between this and your own state constitutions. In other words, we're going to show you that we haven't veered that far from your own state constitutions in what we're proposing. And lastly, I intend in these papers to address the additional security which adoption of this system, this constitution, will do to the preservation of that government, of the kind of government we need, along with your liberty and the protection of property. The Constitution of the United States, the preamble to the Constitution of the United States, lays out the purposes of the Constitution. We, the people of the United States, in order to ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, etc., 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 do hereby create this Union. Well, now what Hamilton is doing is laying out the preamble to this series of papers that he's going to write by telling people exactly this is what we're going to do. And then finally, in his final paragraph, he says, the fact is that we already hear it whispered in the private circles of those who oppose the new Constitution that the 13 states are of too great extent for any general system, and that we must of necessity resort to separate confederacies of distinct portions of the whole. He returns to the danger that he opened the paper with at the very beginning. The rumors that are flying around about maybe we ought to create a series of regional confederacies to replace the Articles of Confederation rather than go all the way towards this new constitution, which is going to create a union of all the states. I would suggest that the fact that Hamilton returns to that at the end of the first Federalist paper, which is the same concern he expresses at the beginning of the first Federalist paper, is an indication as to how seriously the Federalists take this threat of breaking up the Union into a series of regional confederacies. I think that's extremely important and extremely significant. That's Federalist number one. That's the introductory paper to the most famous series of papers and documents related to the operations of the American political system ever written. Nobody ever reads it. What a beautifully written, beautifully conceived piece of work. It's admirable. The fact of the matter is, how many people could read it and understand it? It appears in the papers of New York, Saturday, October 27th, 1787. I've tried to make a special point, because I'm captivated by the quality of the writing, the quality of the prose. But now what I'm confronting is the reality of the audience. We would have to believe that the people of 1787, on average, are so much brighter and read so much better than we do today. That's the only justification, the only explanation for this document, as well written and well structured as it is, to appear in the New York newspapers. Unless we recognize something else, it is more likely that human nature hasn't changed that much between 1787 and today. I think we have to conclude that most people, on average, didn't read any better then than they read today. And if that's true, then all you have to do is look into the classrooms of America today in order to realize that there aren't that many students in our high schools today who could sit down and read this document and appreciate it for what it says. This is a level of writing and analysis and takes a degree of critical reading that our students don't have. It'll be rare to find 5 students in a class of 30 that could really handle this document. I'm asking you to think along with me. I'm trying to make a point here because I think it's important. I think politically it's very important. I have to believe that the people in the 1780s were no more intelligent. Human nature was the same then as it is now. And I have to believe that the vast majority of the people of New York would not be able to read this either. Consequently, we are confronted with the reality. Who reads the newspapers? For many, many years in my classes, college classes, I've tried to make it a point to take a poll. How many people read the paper every day? How many people know what's going on? How many people know what the news is? And what you find scares you. I have to believe that you would find the same thing in this period, perhaps even more so. because illiteracy rates, while the literacy rate in America was as high or higher than in many countries, the fact of the matter is there were still a lot of people that couldn't read. So we know that they didn't read this document. But we also know that even the people who could read probably couldn't read this document and really understand it. So that leads us to the next conundrum or challenge. Why would Hamilton put this in the newspaper at all if most people couldn't read it and understand it? Unless he knew that going in. If that's true, if you read this document, it's pretty obvious that the person who wrote it's pretty sharp and pretty shrewd and pretty articulate and understands politics very well. This guy understands the ins and outs of argument. He would know how to challenge Matlock or Perry Mason. He would know how you make an argument which causes the jury, in this case the people reading this, to see through the assumptions of the other side, of his opponents. This is pretty sophisticated, high-powered stuff that Hamilton's engaging in here. So he's a pretty sharp guy. Consequently, one would have to conclude that if a large number of people, the reading public out there, either couldn't read this article at all, or even if they could read the words, they couldn't understand it. Chances are Hamilton knew that. So consequently, we're left with a question. Who's Hamilton writing to? If there are large numbers of people out there that can't read it, or will not be able to understand it even if they can read it, then who's he writing to? He's obviously writing to a minority, a very articulate, shrewd minority. He's communicating with the key political players in the state of New York. He's sending the word out to all the counties and all the boroughs of New York and Manhattan and up New York State and everything else. He's sending out the word that I'm proposing to put together a series of papers which is going to take apart this Constitution and address it, and is going to show us why we need it, why it's going to solve our problems, why it's going to preserve Republican government, why it's going to protect property, why it's going to be what we need, why the union is important to preserve in order to make it all work. And so anybody who's out there who was having problems with the Confederation, creditors, who were being forced by law in their states to accept paper money and postponements in debts and government interference with contracts and all the rest of the interferences that the state government is making in the free operation of a market, in the buying and selling of goods and services, is going to be tuned into this and saying, this is exactly what we need. What this guy is proposing is exactly what this country needs. Those are the people you're talking to. And what he's saying is, I'm going to basically be able to tell you how this is going to work and why it's going to work. That's what we're doing. We are talking to the people who know. And it's going to be our job to get this baby ratified. And we've got to be prepared, he says, for the fact that there are people out there who have a vested interest in beating us, in making sure that we never ratify this document. And what they're going to do is because we're advocating a government that's going to be more energetic and more vigorous and more stable and more secure and is going to work and is really going to govern, they're going to try to paint us as enemies to people's rights and people's freedoms. Be aware that history tells us that we're not the people you need to worry about, it's them. The people that pretend to stand out there and be defending people's freedoms and people's liberties and their rights, they're the ones that history shows us have become the ones who are most dangerous, because they tend to evolve from populist spokesmen to demagogues to out-and-out tyrants. And so he's basically suggesting this is what the opponents are going to say about us, this is what they're going to say about the system we're proposing, but this is what we propose to do. We're going to enter into a series of papers which is going to make it very clear why we need this system, why your future prosperity requires that this sucker be approved. My God, what a beautiful, beautiful case. I would suggest to you this document is a very important part of the Federalist Papers. The mere fact that it's the first one suggests in many ways how important it is, because it lays out the strategy and the rationale, the approach for all the ones that follow. Hamilton's not going to write them all. He's going to write most of them. But once you get by number one, John Jay's going to take over, because John Jay's the expert on foreign policy. He's the one that negotiated, you know, he's the one that negotiates with Spain over opening up the Mississippi. He's the one that's involved in negotiating the peace treaty. His focus, his priority as an attorney, is on foreign policy. He's going to become the first Chief Justice of the Supreme Court under this Constitution. He's going to take on the issue of foreign policy, and he's going to make it clear why in our relations with other nations we've got to have this system. Then he's going to pass the baton off to James Madison, who's going to lay out in detail, in chapter and verse, exactly how the system is structured and how it's going to work, and that's what we're going to see in Federalist number 39 when we get back to these in our first program next week. I hope you'll find these interesting. This is stuff that we've always said we know about, we understand, and very few people read. I think that this really gets us into the substantive reasons why the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility is even needed. Because I think in future programs in coming weeks, we're going to give people a sense and an understanding of the American political process that they've never had an opportunity to secure in any other place. I'm really excited about it. It's going to force me to do some reading and rereading and rethinking on my own. It's going to be heavy. It's going to be tough sledding. But, man, it's going to be informative for all of us. And I look forward to you to participate actively in this process with me. So as we close out our week today, first of all, I want to thank you for being with us. It's 58. We've got 2 minutes before Bob Kincaid goes on the air. I want to thank you for your support of the Virtual Center. I want to thank you for your continuing support of the Head On Radio Network. Where else could anything like this even happen? Let's do our best to keep this baby alive. We need this. America needs this. I want to thank you for support. I want to encourage you to have a wonderful week and weekend. Be safe. Don't eat all the candy that you get on Thursday night. And let's get back together on Monday. And we'll start off by looking at Federalist 59 and Madison's approach to the whole nature of Republican government. Thank you for tuning in today. I'm Bill O'Brien. This is the Virtual Center. Be safe, and thank you.